let us start on chemical equilibrium. Now, this chapter, we have to discuss about nature of reaction. Certain reactions are called as reversible reaction, and certain reactions are called as irreversible reaction. Let us take one example. Suppose I am having diamond. You are aware diamond is having symbol as C. It is allotrope of carbon. So what's your thing? We can write down the formula of diamond as C. So I am burning out diamond. Burning means we have to combine it with oxygen. So I am burning out diamond. What is the expected product? We are getting very pure carbon dioxide, because diamond is purest allotrope of carbon. So almost 100% carbon is present. So it will give me purest carbon dioxide. So this way I can obtain carbon dioxide. But suppose by any means I am removing oxygen from carbon dioxide, then I am not getting diamond again or carbon again. So this type of reaction, which proceeds only in forward direction is from here to here, but backward direction is not possible, that is called as irreversible reaction. Whereas certain reactions, say for example, CuSO4, copper sulfate plus water. Now here I am purposefully writing arrow like this, forward and backward. That will give me CuOH twice plus H2SO4. Now in order to balance this, there must be H2SO4, yes, and CuOH twice, not able to balance out, so I have to write down 2. Then 2OH, that will be there, and we are getting H2SO4. So this way, we can balance out this reaction. Now, this reaction is called as forward reaction. Whereas, when we are adding out concentrated H2SO4 to this side, then reaction takes place in backward direction. So this reaction is called as backward. So whenever reaction is carried out in both way, forward as well as backward, then that is called as reversible reaction. If reaction is carried out in only one way, then that is called as irreversible. We have to think of irreversible reaction first. Then we will switch over to reversible reaction. Wherever we are carrying out irreversible reaction, the entire reactant, say for example, I am taking that same example, carbon plus oxygen, that will give me carbon dioxide. So entire reagent or reactant, they are converted into product. Whereas wherever we are carrying out reversible reaction, let us take example of reversible reaction as that again, the formation of CuOH twice. So CuSO4 plus 2H2O, that will give me CuOH twice plus H2SO4. Now this reaction will never go for completion in 100% automatically, because rate of forward reaction and rate of backward reaction will get balanced out at certain place. Now we have to discuss about the rate of reaction. Say any time we can discuss about rate of reaction as this way, that amount of reagent consumed per unit time or amount of products formed per unit time. So this is for forward reaction, this is reagent or reactant, whereas these are products. So with respect to forward reaction, I can say the rate of forward reaction, that is equal to increase in the concentration of product divided by time in the given time. What is the rise in the concentration of product or amount of the product? Or I can say rate of forward reaction like this, that decrease in the concentration or amount of reactant upon given time. In the unit time or in the same time, what is the decrease in the concentration of reactant? That is also called as
rate of forward reaction.
Now this way we can able to find out rate of reaction. Now rate of reaction depends upon variety of factor. The first thing, nature of reactant. Whether reactants are ready to react or not, it depends upon the system energy and bond strength also. We have discussed this factor in earlier lecture. We are revising this factor again. Say for example, wherever reaction is carried out, reaction means what? Breaking of existing bond and making of new bonds. Sometime, if elemental reactants are there, then making of new bond, that is the reaction. And keep in mind this law, for breaking of bond, energy is required. If making of bond is there, then energy is released. I am revising. Whenever bond breaking is there, energy is required. And wherever bond making is there, energy is liberated. Now, suppose we have fluorine. Then F is very, very highly reactive. It is so reactive, it reacts with another F to form F2. Now, there is single bond between F and M. The fluorine atom is very small. You are aware there are only two orbitals. First orbit contains 2 electrons, 7 contains 7 electrons. This is another fluorine and there is overlap between fluorine and fluorine. Now these two nuclei are also close to each other because fluorine is the smallest atom in its particular period. And so nuclei are very close. As a result, very less energy is required to break the bond because nuclear repulsive forces are dominant and therefore with small energy fluorine bond can be ruptured and we get two nascent fluorine. But this is not case in case of N2. Actually nitrogen is also very, very highly reactive, but it is so reactive that it combines with another nitrogen. As a result, we are getting N2 as N triple bond N. There is triple bond between nitrogen and nitrogen and tremendous energy is required to break that triple bond. And therefore, N2 is very less reactive in nature. I am not saying it is inert, but it is very less reactive and in many chemical reactions, we are using nitrogen as inert material. It is not actually inert, but it is very, very, very less reactive. Under normal circumstances, it is not going for reaction. And so, this is the nature of reagent. Depending upon the interatomic bonds present, the reactivity is there. Suppose interatomic bonds are stronger, then reactivity is less. Suppose bonds are weaker, reactivity is more. So this way we can able to find out the nature. Then suppose alkali metals are there, alkali metals are very highly reactive. Alkaline earth metals are comparatively less reactive. If you are aware in electrochemical series, suppose elements are at top or extreme bottom, then they are more active. The elements towards middle side, they are less reactive. So like that we can able to predict out according to nature of reagent and saturation or unsaturation, the reactivity is there. So first thing, that reactivity or rate of reaction depends upon the nature of the thing. That what is the physical state or nature of that solid state substance. Let us take physical state. We are carrying out reaction in only three states, that is solid, liquid and gas. So in case of solid state, reactivity is less compared to liquid and gaseous state reactivity is highest. So the nature of reagent, suppose reagent is in gaseous state, then it will show greatest reactivity, liquid state somewhat less reactivity and solid state still lesser reactivity is shown. Now in case of solid substances, the particle size that determines speed of reaction. So whenever solid substance is there, suppose this is the shape of substance, then whatever shape of substance, reactivity is carried out only on surface of the reaction is carried out only on the surface of the substance. So whatever the bulk, bulk means inside present, that is not important. First surface molecules will undergo reaction and then inner molecules will undergo reaction. So let us take an example. This is the cube. And each side has 2 cm. So what is the surface area of this cube? 2, 2, 2, 2, everywhere 2. So simply first face that should have area 4 square cm. Same way there are number of faces. Cube means first, second, third, fourth, behind fifth and sixth. So total 6 faces are there. So I can calculate area as 4 into 6, that is 24 square centimeter. Now I am dividing this cube into 1 cleavage, cleavage means cutting exactly from center point, vertical cleavage is there, and still one more cleavage from this side. So this way we are dividing, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. So total 8 cubes we are able to produce. This is also part of cleavage only. So new that vertical cleavage, that will give me total this thing. So here also and here. So this way I am getting total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. So total 8 cubes we have formed. Each one is having now area, length and breadth, that means side as 1 centimeter. So area 1 into 1, 1. 6 faces are there. So 1 cube is having area 1 into 6, that is 6 square centimeter. Like that 8 cubes are there. That means 8 into 6, that will be equal to 48 square centimeter. So just by dividing this way, we are able to form 8 cubes of size 1 centimeter. Then we are having surface area 48 square centimeter. So obviously reactivity will be doubled. The rate of reaction will be doubled over here because surface area is doubled. So this way, suppose I am cutting out big crystal into fine powder, then rate of reaction will be definitely very, very high. So rate of reaction depends upon number one, nature of the reagent, number two, physical state, and if solid state are there, then particle size. That is the determining factor. Now we have to find out effect of concentration on the rate of reaction. Now first thing, let's consider in what way reaction is going to take place. Let us consider reaction between hydrogen and chlorine. Both are in gaseous state. So hydrogen and chlorine, they are reacting to give HCl. In order to balance, we have to write 2 over here. Now in this case, there is hydrogen molecule. So this is hydrogen molecule, this is chlorine molecule. When reaction is there, these two molecules should collide each other. On collision, there will be exchange of electrons and then it will give HCl. So the initial stage, there should be collision between molecule. Whether reactant is in gaseous state, solid state, liquid state, whatever the state, if collision is there, then only reaction will be there. Without collision, we are not expecting the reaction. And so, it is obvious that when these two molecules are colliding, then only reaction will be there. Now suppose, I am increasing the concentration. Then obvious thing, or in case of this gaseous state, I can say increase in pressure. The obvious thing is that on increasing pressure, these molecules will collide more frequently. The probability of collision increases. If the liquid state reagents are there, say for example NaOH is reacting with HCl in order to give NaCl plus water. Then in order to that, the NaOH molecule should collide with HCl molecule. If I am increasing concentration of NaOH or HCl or both, then the number of collisions, obvious thing, that as we are increasing our concentration or increasing our pressure, the number of collisions and probability of number of collisions both increases, and as a result rate of reaction also increases. So rate of reaction is directly proportional to concentration. As concentration of reagent increases, rate of reaction increases. As pressure, suppose reaction is carried out in gaseous state or one of the component is in gaseous state, then as pressure increases, rate of reaction also increases. So this way we can say that rate of reaction depends on concentration. As concentration and pressure both are going to increase, rate of reaction definitely increases. Now same thing is there about temperature. So whenever we are increasing our temperature, if reagents are in solid state, in case of solid state, the atom or molecule that is in vibratory state. So vibration increases, simply amplitude. Amplitude means what? Displacement from mean positions. So this way amplitude increases. So instead of vibrating in this part, atom can vibrate this way. Still we are giving energy, heat, that means it will vibrate in this way. And this way amplitude or say vibration increases in case of solid state. Suppose liquid state is there, then molecules kinetic energy increases. What is kinetic energy? Try to recollect our physics lecture. Kinetic energy is equal to half mv square. M stands for mass and v stands for velocity. So I can't increase mass of molecule. Mass of molecule is constant. Half is also constant. So as kinetic energy increases, that means mass remains constant, so velocity increases, and therefore the molecules start moving in fast way. So as temperature increases, the speed of atom or speed of molecule increases. Same way in gaseous state also, their kinetic energy increases. So as a result, chances of collision, probability of collision increases. As a result, rate of reaction usually increases. So keep in mind, rise in temperature will increase the rate of reaction usually. Why I am again and again using word usually? Because there are two types of reaction. One reaction according to heat or according to energy, two types of reactions are there. One reaction is carried out, then heat is evolved. Other reaction is carried out, heat is absorbed. Best example is there in front of you. Suppose I am heating out charcoal, that means ordinary coal, charcoal, I am burning out. Burning out means combining with oxygen. It will become very hot. That means energy is evolved in the process. It will start emitting light, it will start emitting heat. This way, reaction is called as exothermic in nature. Exo, throwing away. Heat throwing reaction, therefore we are calling therma means heat. So exothermic reaction. So such reactions we are calling as exothermic reaction when heat is thrown away. If heat is absorbed, then that reaction is called as endothermic reaction. So certain reactions are exothermic, certain reactions are endothermic. Exothermic reaction, heat is thrown away. Endothermic reaction, heat is taken in. Now, usually, whenever exothermic reaction is there, then there is doubt whether reaction's rate will increase or not. But endothermic reaction is there, then on heating, rate of reaction increases surely. So this way, we can predict about temperature. So rate of reaction, now again reverse, depend upon nature of reagent, concentration of reagent, pressure of reagent, suppose gaseous reaction, then physical state of reagent, particle size of reagent, temperature of reagent, and one more important factor is there, that is called as catalyst. What is the role of catalyst? Catalyst is a substance which is not taking part in the reaction, but because of its presence, rate of reaction increases. I'm revising. Catalyst is the substance which is not taking part in reaction theoretically, but because of its presence, the rate of reaction increases. Then that is called as catalyst. Certain condition, we are calling that catalyst as retarder also. That means rate of reaction decreases because of certain substances. But here we are saying catalyst. Catalyst means rate of reaction increases. Now, exactly what happens by use of catalyst? We are saying theoretically it is not taking part in the reaction, but in practical, catalyst is taking part in the reaction. Let us think of this way. Wherever any chemical reaction is carried out, suppose on this axis we are giving energy of the system and here we are giving time. Suppose this is the total energy of reactor. Then theoretically, say I am writing this way, this is the energy of reactor. Then when time proceeds, it will attain some unstable or very high energetic way. This is called as transition state. This is graphical representation. We are getting some transition state. Then whatever the absorbed energy is there, that is evolved. And still, suppose exothermic reaction is there, still more energy is evolved. And then it will give a energy of product. So this is energy of reactant, this is energy of product, whereas this is called as transition state. Transition state is temporary state, which is not permanent because some unusual conditions are there. You are aware carbon is tetravalent. Tetravalent means carbon can form four bonds. But in case of transition state, carbon can have three bonds or five bonds also. Imperfectly five bonds, but still that is something unusual. So such a states are energetically very high. So we are giving there this energy. Now suppose reaction with constant energy is produced, then this should be energy of reactant and this should be energy of product. Whereas this is the energy for transition state. So whatever energy we have to supply so that reagent will give that transition state, that energy is called as energy of activation. Whereas when heat is evolved, this is called as delta H, enthalpy change or heat of reaction. This much energy is actually evolved. This energy initially absorbed and then evolved. So this way one can say energy of activation depends the nature of reactant. Say for example, I am taking carbon in oxygen. What is the expected product? We can expect carbon and oxygen only. In order to start reaction, we have to heat. Why we have to heat? Because carbon and oxygen system should be taken to transition state. So initially I have to supply energy. But once carbon dioxide is formed, the energy is evolved. Because this is the energy of carbon dioxide. So this much energy, that is energy of activation, that is also evolved, and plus delta H, that is also evolved. So this way energy is evolved. Now by using this energy and this whatever liberated energy, other carbon will get activated and reaction proceeds. So initially we have to ignite, then carbon burning starts continuously. The reason is that whatever absorbed energy, that is going to evolve. Now this energy is called as energy of activation. You are aware that bond making energy is evolved, bond breaking energy is required. Now whenever we are inserting a catalyst, say this is the surface of catalyst, molecules get adsorbed over catalyst. What is adsorbed? Adsorbed means accumulation of one substance over another. Then that is called as adsorption. Here I am writing on this board. So whatever ink is there, that ink is adsorbed, adhere to this whiteboard. So this is called as adsorption. Instead of that, suppose I am using chalk, then chalk particles should be attached, that is adsorbed on the surface of blackboard. You can check out adsorption very easily. Take muddy water, filter it off. then also certain suspended impurities are there. To that, add activated charcoal. Just make powder of charcoal, heat it for a while, don't burn out, just heat for a while, and then add to that water. Shake it well, allow that carbon to settle down, you'll find that entire color is disappearing. This is the process of refining of oil. Whenever vegetable oil is there, we have to refine, we have to add activated charcoal and allow it to stand for some time. Stir it very well and allow it to stand for some time. Whatever the impurities, that means coloring matter, odor, that will get absorbed on charcoal, and then we can filter it off. Now here, same adsorption is carried out. So this is physical adsorption. Some sort of very weak bond is formed. That bond is called as van der Waals bond. So very weak bond is formed. But you are aware, as bond is formed, energy is evolved. The second thing, many times the catalyst belong to d-block element, and d-block elements are having capacity to form coordinate bond. They are forming coordinate bond. So strength wise ionic bond is stronger, then covalent bond, and then coordinate bond. So whenever coordinate bond is formed, energy is evolved. That is no doubt comparatively lower energy than covalent and than ionic bond, but greater energy than van der Waals bond. So that energy is evolved either of two reasons. Number one, formation of adsorption process, and number two, formation of coordinate bond. So whatsoever matter, we are concerned that with catalyst certain energies evolve, and therefore this is the energy of reaction. Then with help of catalyst can supply this much of energy. That means I have to supply only this much of energy now, and because of that the energy of activation decreases and reaction become faster. When extra energy is liberated, the adsorption process is reversed. That is called as desorption, and molecule is desorbed from this. The formed molecule is desorbed from this because energy is required to break that bond. But that energy is available from this portion and this portion. And so desorption is carried out. We are having return of catalyst as it is. So we feel that catalyst is not consumed, and therefore we are saying catalyst is not taking part in the reaction. This is the reason we are saying. But practically speaking, during the reaction course, catalyst is not forming covalent or ionic bond, but it is forming weak van der Waals bond or coordinate bond. Moreover, catalyst by adsorbing substances provides site of reaction. Two molecules are in motion, whereas catalyst will adsorb one. So one molecule will be stationary, so rate of collision will be more. And therefore, we are getting increase in rate of reaction with help of catalyst. So we are discussing here factors affecting rate of reaction. Now you are aware, number one, we can say nature of reagent or nature of reactant. Second, concentration, pressure, then particle size, physical state, temperature, and lastly use of proper catalyst can alter rate of. Now we are aware that factors affecting rate of reaction. Let us start hypothetical reaction A combining with B to give C plus D. Now initially the concentration of A, let us take 1 molar. Concentration of B, that is also we can take 1 mole or 1 molar, whereas concentration of C and D is 0 because we have not started the reaction. Rate of reaction is directly proportional to concentration of the reagent. As a result, we can get reaction started over here between A and B. Then after some time, say after time equal to T, you can find that some X part is undergoing reaction. So this will be also 1 minus X, whereas this will be X and this will be X. So this way C and D are formed now. Graphically, I can say this way. This is the amount of substance, let us take in terms of kilogram in the reaction course form, and this is time. So initially, let us take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. So initially I am taking 5 kg of reactant. So this is the starting point in another color in order to locate product. So concentration of product is 0, whereas concentration of reactant is 5. After some time, reaction proceeds. That means concentration of reactant start decreasing out, because as reaction will proceed, we are having decreasing concentration of reagent. But at the same time, you will find that concentration of products is increasing, because reagents are converted into product, and so you will get increase in concentration of product, and at the same time you will get some decrease in concentration of reagent. But this is something like curve. This is not a straight line, this is also curve, and it will balance out at some point. This will also balance out at this point only. This condition we are calling as equilibrium, because as concentration of C and D increases, they will start giving reaction in backward direction. As a result, we are getting reaction in forward direction as well as in backward direction, and ultimately a stage will reach where rate of forward reaction is exactly equal to rate of backward reaction. Therefore, practically we found that reaction is not proceeding, reaction is stagnant. But this is not, because at this time A plus B reacting to give C plus D, whereas C plus D are giving reacting reaction in backward direction forming A plus B. So this is not a steady equilibrium, this is called as dynamic equilibrium, because reaction is going on but concentration remains same, and so amount of substance here remains same as long as reagent is reaction is continuously going on. So this condition is called as equilibrium, the balancing out condition. When we can call it this as equilibrium, when rate of forward reaction is exactly equal to rate of backward reaction. Let us derive something. Rate of forward reaction is directly proportional to concentration of reagent. That means I can say concentration of A into concentration of B. Whenever I am using this square bracket, particularly here, the meaning is that this is molar concentration of A, this is molar concentration of B. Rate of backward reaction, that will be directly proportional to formation of concentration of C and concentration of D. This is multiplication. So whenever we are saying rate of forward reaction is equal to rate of backward reaction, obviously here I have to take another step. This is called as removing this proportionality sign. So I can write here RF, that is rate of forward reaction, is equal to, I can take one constant, that is constant of forward reaction into concentration of A into concentration of B. Same way rate of backward reaction, that is equal to, I am removing this proportionality sign by keeping here one constant KB, that is constant for backward reaction into concentration of C into concentration of D. So this way we have equation for rate of forward reaction and equation for backward reaction. What is the equilibrium condition? When rate of forward reaction is equal to rate of backward reaction, this condition is called as equilibrium condition. So at equilibrium we can say that rate of forward reaction, that is equal to KF into concentration of A into concentration of B, that is equal to KB into concentration of C into concentration of D. I am taking KB on this side and AB on this side. So KF upon KB, that is equal to concentration of C into concentration of D upon concentration of A into concentration of B. Now you are aware, what is KF constant? What is KB constant? So KF by KB, that is also constant. So I can write down simply this as only K. So instead of writing Kf by Kb, because Kf is also constant and Kb is also constant. So constant divided by constant, that sum is also constant. So I am writing this K, this is called as equilibrium constant. So equilibrium constant is equal to product. Why in book they are using word product, I don't know. Instead of that, we can use word multiplication, that is more correct word here. Because in chemistry, product means reactant and product. And in mathematics, product means multiplication. So here I can use another word as multiplication. So I can say here, the multiplication of molar concentration of product divided by multiplication of molar concentration of reactant. Then this is called as equilibrium law, or this is called as law of mass action. I can determine value of K by knowing all concentration. This K is called as equilibrium constant. I'm just going out from the frame. What is the required thing you have to take down? You can take down graph, first write down reaction, then take down graph, then write down equilibrium condition, then start from here. What is RF? Sequentially go till here and then write down this and mark this as law of mass action.